Secretary, will you take the roll call, please? Here. Thank you. May I have a motion to approve the minutes from the work session of February 8th and the regular meeting of February 22nd? Properly moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Moved by Mr. Gaino and seconded by Mr. Stoltzfus.
Speaking online tonight?
Just doing it for the camera there.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
She's not, and the speaking is not online tonight.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. We'll move on to presentations or discussions, our budget discussion. Mr. Kirk.
Thank you. So I'd just like to bring the board up to date on where we are in the budget process. Just a recap, our 2016-2017 proposed revenues are $49.434 million, as you can see at the top there. Our proposed expenditures are $52.405 million, resulting in a deficit of $2.9 million, as you can see the third line here. We've talked about we're allowed to increase taxes up to 3%. That's our Act 1 tax increase. That does not include any exceptions to the tax, Act 1 tax increase. We eliminated those back in December. So the 3% tax is $964,727. That's what's available to us still to decide to use or not. Also, in our deficit of the $2.97 million, we have budget contingency, which is an amount that we budget for emergencies. We do not anticipate spending that. As far as I know, it might have only been used once here in many, many years. So that we would back out of that $2.97 deficit. We also know that next year we'll have some debt service savings, some one-time debt service savings that we will not have to spend out of the total expenditures of $52.4 million. So that comes out of our deficit. Also, we've budgeted our state revenue at the 2014-2015 levels. Any amount that we get in 2015 and then compounding that into 2016-2017 will be revenue that we will also be able to reduce the 2.97 deficit by. We don't know how much that is right now, so we're not necessarily considering it in the equation. And since last fall, we've come up with proposed budget reductions. I believe we looked at about 30,000 per grade level, plus 30,000 for admin altogether, and that's how we got this 420. We're currently in the process of looking at what those individual budget reduction strategies are. We've been talking about it. We talked about it at length tonight. Anyway, in our original proposal, it was at 420. That would bring our operational deficit down to $895,996. We could balance the budget by including a use of fund balance to bring that down to zero. So that is not a done deal. This is just where we're at in the budget process. Okay, so next month we're scheduled to adopt the 2016-2017 proposed final budget and then make that budget available to the public using the PD, the Pennsylvania Department of Education official budget document. So unless otherwise directed, the document will show total revenues and expenditures like we just saw on the last slide with a 3% tax increase. And then when you add that to the deficit of 2.9, it brings it down to 2.005. So on the last slide, we talked about that $2 million deficit isn't necessarily what we believe would happen. We have all these adjustments that we're working on now. However, for this preliminary proposed, or for the proposed final budget, we're only going to show this because this is the only thing we know for sure. Nothing that we approve next month is set in stone. Just because we have the 3% tax increase in there doesn't mean you have to take it. Total revenues and total expenditures, they can change between this proposed final budget and the final budget you vote on in June. You're only voting on this budget next month so that you can display something. You're required to do it by the Act 1 law. So after you do that, at the April 18th board meeting, you adopt the proposed final budget. There's a couple other key items will happen. On May 1st, PDE will, Pennsylvania Department of Education, will notify us how much the property tax relief allocation is. So then I'll be able to tell you for each homestead and farmstead, your tax bill will be reduced by X amount of money according to how much revenue we're told we get in May. I believe I will have a slide that'll show what the average taxpayer, what an Act 3 or an Act 1 increase of 3% is, and then that'll be reduced by the property tax relief based on what they tell us it is in May. So that's coming. If I have it for the next board meeting, then I'll show it then. But they have until May 1st to get that information out. And then on June 20th at our board meeting, that's when we adopt the final 2016-2017 budget and millage rates. If it doesn't get adopted on June 20th, unlike the state, you're legally required to have one by June 30th. So we'll be in here again, hopefully with changes that would allow you to pass the budget. So we've talked about budget reduction strategies and then the possible use of the Act 1 3% tax increase. These are a list of all the dates where we can still talk about the strategy and determine what our final budget will be. I have listed here all of our board work sessions. We can talk about it then. Finance committee meetings, and then later that night at the board meeting. So we have several opportunities still to discuss this. Again, nothing has to be decided right now, and nothing that you vote on next month will be set in stone. We still have all these dates to talk about this. So that's where we're at with the budget right now. Are there any questions?
I don't have any questions, comments. We had a lengthy hour and a half almost discussion in finance about the list of potential reductions. There we've been given a list of potential reductions. Some are obviously more impactful than others. They're all impactful, but again, there are various degrees of impact. So again, we had a great discussion. Does anybody have any additional comments at this point? Again, as Mr. Curtis pointed out, we have a lot of opportunities, even though we really don't have a lot of time, but we do have some more opportunities to talk. Okay.
Right. I just wanted to say thank you for the administrators that showed up to help us weed through some of the impacts of the potential cuts on a, you know, where the rubber meets the road level. I appreciate that.
All right, then. We don't have any comments at this point or questions. We'll move on to, we have no information items, so we'll move on to the Treasurer's Report. And as I believe we mentioned last month, we will no longer be reading off the numbers on the general fund report, but the front page of it will be available and is visible with the minutes that are reported every month. So I need a motion to approve the general fund report.
So moved.
Promptly moved and second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. We'll move on to the business manager's report. Mr. Curtis.
Sure. We are presenting checks from the general fund in the amount of $3,417,068.74. And in the cafeteria fund in the amount of $24,867.45. And in the capital projects fund in the amount of $1,236.40. For a total of $3,443,172.59. We're submitting these checks for consideration and authorization for payment.
I need a motion to approve the list of bills. And it was moved by Mr. Solsus and seconded by Mr. Alexander. Is there any discussion?
Yeah, Jeff, the only one I stuck out a little bit to me was, again, another employee, and there's the description is for equipment and rental. It's check number 181058. And I know he has some pretty specialized stuff. I just wanted to know.
Yeah, during that big snow removal, the snowstorm, we did have to rent. One of our employees owns a small backhoe, or okay. I think it's like a tractor kind of thing. And so we actually rented that piece of equipment from him. And
right.
It's a lot cheaper than if we rented it at a company. Plus, he was able to run it then. So we did do it as a rental from the individual.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? Comments? We'll proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye. Opposed? Motion passes. And that brings us to visitors' comments. If you're a visitor this evening and you have a comment pertaining to an agenda item at this point, this would be your opportunity. Visitors' comments, agenda items only. At this point, you'll have another opportunity later on comments in general. All right, then. We have no visitors' comments at this point. So I need a motion for the recommended action items. Last week we went through items A all the way, three pages later, to item V. Item V is supplementals, and there are some additions to the supplemental contracts that I will read. They were italicized. There's Jennifer George as a mentor for Megan Thomas, Devin DeFranks as the junior high track coach, and Steve McBride as a senior high musical assistant. So unless there is an objection or you want an item pulled, I'd like a motion for letters A through V. All right, properly moved by Mr. Fox and seconded by Mr. Solsius. All right, any discussion? Sorry, Mr. Gano, me too. Okay, all right. That guy and that guy. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Actually, I should have put that W and X in there as you were sitting there. Okay, well, let's just do W and X. We went through W and X last week, so I need a motion for W and X. Properly moved by Mr. Gano and seconded by Mr. Alexander. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Y, that the Board of Directors accept the resignation of Ms. Ricky Jones as a lunch playground supervisor at the intermediate school effective March 11th, 2016. She has accepted a position at the senior high. Properly moved by Mr. Stolzfus and seconded by Mr. Gano. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Z, that the Board of Directors approve Ms. Ricky Jones is an instructional assistant for the in-school suspension at the senior high effective March 14, 2016. Ms. Jones' rate will be $11.01 per hour for 5.75 hours per day, and she's replacing a resignation.
Second.
Properly moved by Mr. Gano, seconded by Mr. Norris. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Double A, that the Board of Directors approve Mr. Dominic Brown as the in-school suspension monitor at the senior high, pending completion of employee-related documents required by law in the district Mr. Brown's rate will be $10.25 per hour for 5.75 hours per day, and that's replacing a transfer. Properly moved by Mr. Gano, seconded by Mr. Alexander. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Double B, that the Board of Directors approve Ms. Tara Busby as an instructional.
Go ahead.
Ms. Busby is as a instructional assistant at the junior high, effective March 21st, 2016, pending completion of employee-related documents required by law in the district. Ms. Busby rate will be $10.25 per hour for 5.75 hours per day.
And before there are movements, Ms. Busby has indicated she is not going to accept the position. So I would ask that there not be a motion or a second and let it die where it's at.
All right, then. All right, not hearing a motion for that, we will continue to double C. You have an addendum at your seat, and double C, that the Board of Directors approve the payment of $3,062 to Jason Ralston for coverage for the emotional support teacher at the junior high from August 31st, 2015 through November 23rd, 2015 until the position was filled. Mr. Ralston is a special education teacher at the high school. Properly moved by Mr. Stolzis and seconded by Mr. Gano. Any discussion?
The wording in the agenda item or the backup? The coverage was for pieces that required a special education certificate, IP meetings. Do you see the attachment to your addendum? It's okay. It outlines the kinds of things that were done until Mr. Durkin came from the school he was at to be in place. And I apologize if that was just put on your table, but we figured you might as well take care of it this evening. Because
can you explain the loss of planning time portion of that?
Some of what he did was during his planning time during the day, and that's technically by contract time that we need to pay for. They are hourly rates, but we're paying him this amount for pieces that we had to have the work done, and they had to be done by a person with his certifications. Okay. You're welcome.
All good. Any other questions? All those in favor say aye. Opposed? Motion passes, and we'll move on to the Finance Committee report. Mr. Gano.
The Finance Committee met tonight at 5:30 p.m. We first looked over, or Jeff presented the rationale for increasing the food service price, the old prices versus new, for both lunch and breakfast, and there was a few questions on that. Then we went into the 2016-2017 budget discussion, got an update on the status of state funding, and that we all were very happy about that. That's sarcasm. And then looked at some budget reductions for the next hour and 20 minutes about, as you referenced. And I thought it was a very good discussion, and I'm not sure where we're landing on those, but, you know, that was a lot of open and frank discussion. So that's what we did during the Finance Committee meeting.
Any questions? Any more clarification? All right, then we'll move on to the IU CAP Board Representative's report. Mr. Alexander.
The Chester County Intermediate Unit Board of Directors held its monthly meeting on March 16th, 2016 at the CCIU Learning Center in Coastal, Pennsylvania. There's one item I wanted to mention. The CCIU Board of Directors reviewed in first reading the draft of the 2016-17 marketplace budgets. Joe O'Brien, CCIU Executive Director, and Joe Lebitsky, CCIU Director of Administrative Services, presented the 2016-17 draft budget to board members. The CCIU board will vote on the marketplace budget on April 20th. A key point made was the cost of marketplace programs for purchase by Chester County school districts will increase by only 1.96% for the 2016-17 year. The next CCIU board of directors meeting will be held on Wednesday, April 20th, 2016. At 7:30 p.m. at the Chester County Technical College High School Pennock Bridge campus in West Grove. That concludes my report. If there's any questions.
All right, any questions?
Hey, Tim, what do you mean by marketplace?
The marketplaces are services that are extra services that are sell to school districts outside of Chester County, kind of offsets our costs.
Yeah. Other examples of marketplace services would be something like, actually, their special education services are marketplace services, and we have in the past gone other places for those services because of availability or because of the market and what it costs.
Any else?
All right, we do not have any old business or any new business this evening. Any other items or announcements? All right, that brings us to visitors' comments in general. If you're a visitor this evening and you have a comment in general, this would be your opportunity to come forward. Visitors' comments in general. Come on down. What I need you to come forward, and thank you. All right, and if you could just let us know your name and where you live. Not your address, just the town or township.
My name is Seneca McCall, and I live in Calkinville. I'm in sixth grade.
My name is Jack Rocky, and I live in Parksburg.
I am Paige Linnabaugh, and I live in Christiana.
I think for all of us going, this year we've been picked to participate in the Chorus Fest, and it was truly an extraordinary experience. I met a lot of new friends and a lot of new people, and I'm sure these two have too. And it was just really fun, and having all of the different districts with all their beautiful voices coming together and singing as one is just it was an amazing experience. Mm-hmm. And music really helps me, like, with confidence, and it's, like, I mean, with all the different chorus groups we're in, performing in front of all those people with all the hard work that has come with it, it's really cool once it all comes together, and once you're all done with performing, I feel amazing, because I just feel, like, this rush of energy going through me, and I just feel great. It definitely helps me with my confidence, and I probably wouldn't be able to speak in front of all of you without having some of that confidence from music and all the groups that we are in. So
these are three of eight students that were picked from fourth through sixth grade to participate in the Pennsylvania Music Educators Association Chorus Fest. Last Friday, they joined about 120 other students from other schools in southeastern Pennsylvania. They've been coming in early Thursday mornings for maybe 3 months to work with Ms. Smack and Mr. Lynch on some really challenging music. So they all met at the high school. They got to work with the other students who'd been learning the same music and work with one of the best conductors in the area to join all the parts that they learned together. So really great opportunity for our students.
So I'm just going to ask you to repeat what you've probably already said. So what grade did the Choral Fest?
This was 4 through 6.
And did they all sing together?
They
so they
all sang all together,
learned their parts,
all
and then
126 students, I think, had
okay.
learned the same song,
okay.
5 songs, different parts. They all came together, spent the day together, working with a conductor that they had never worked with before to put all those parts together. And then that night they gave a concert where parents and faculty and friends could come, and it was just an amazing experience.
Wow. And you guys do this every year? Is this a, this is
death? Yes, yeah. Okay. Ms. Smeck and Mr. Lynch, you know, as parents, we're thankful for teachers like them and Mr. Reynolds. I'll tell you in a minute about BandFest, which they just did. Teachers like that who go the extra mile and find incredible opportunities like this for our kids to help them musically, to help them socially. It's, they go above and beyond for our kids, and as parents, we're thankful for that.
And could you identify yourself?
My name's Jenny Graffi. I'm Jack's mom.
Okay.
I was going to fill that in.
And if I could just, if you don't mind, if I read from my phone some information about BandFest that just happened. On Wednesday, March 9th, 6 students from the OIS participated in the 2016 Chester County Band Fest, which is also sponsored by the Pennsylvania Music Education Society Association. All 6 students had to audition for Mr. Reynolds first before being nominated for the event. The students who participated were Maya Hahn, Mackenzie Stanley, Colin Nolan, Megan Gray, Emma Milligan, and Heidi Stoltzfus. These students spent many months preparing music on their own to be ready for the day-long event that was held at Stetson Middle School in the Westchester Area School District on March 9th. The event provides a nice opportunity for our students to get a taste of what music is like across Chester County, and also gives our students a chance to work with other teachers and a new conductor. As always, the students from After Air represented how stellar they are, not only as students, but also as musicians. So thank you for allowing this kind of opportunity for our kids.
Well, thank you, and we appreciate you coming forward. And I know you'd sent an email talking about the Choral Fest and inviting the board directors to come and the community. So thank you. And I know, for, you know, if you've, I'm sure most of us have attended something musically on campus, and you guys do, you do a wonderful job. So thank you. And when you stood up here, I was almost going to jokingly say, "Are you going to sing for you?"
Don't they usually?
But thank you, and congratulations, and thank you. Anyone else? Visitors' comments? Excellent.
Sorry. Judy Reynolds, West Fallowfield Township. I was really hoping I wouldn't have to feel like I had to make comments tonight, that somebody else would maybe say something, because I do have... my son is an employee in the school district. So that's, you know, maybe a little reason why I come to school board meetings, but we do live in the township. So that would be the main reason that I come. I'm retired now, but you know, during my working career, I was involved in a lot of process improvement initiatives and efficiency audits and, you know, how to work smarter, work better, and all that. And it usually involved, you know, quite a bit of discussion around methodology, you know, training participants, what approach we're going to use to talk about whatever initiative was going on at the time. And just in thinking about that during the last couple of weeks in the meeting tonight, I'm wondering how the teachers at the, sounds like at each grade level, they're tasked with coming up with certain line items to help in the budget reduction. And I guess my thoughts are, you know, do they really know how to do this? Do they have the resources, the information resources that they're going to need to maybe tackle this? And just hearing about it, it just sounds a little daunting to me in a pretty tight time frame. So I'm, you know, I don't have any suggestions. I'm just throwing it out there as a concern. But I hate to see people come up with kind of last straw, last minute items just because it could satisfy some budget reduction, but maybe it's not really the best thing. So I just wanted to express that tonight. I thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Reynolds. And thank you for attending our board meetings.
Right. Oh.
Do we have any other board comments at this time? Visitors' comments, I'm sorry. Any other visitor comments? All right, then, we'll move on to any administrator comments or announcements.
I would actually like to acknowledge four OES students who participated in the Chester County Elementary Chorus Fest on Friday. Daryl Andrews, George Gordon, Olivia Simmons, and Sydney Stanton were at Oxford High School on Friday to represent Octorera in this year's Elementary Chorus Fest. They rehearsed all day and then performed a concert in the evening with about 130 other elementary students from around Chester County. Congratulations to these four OES students.
And I just wanted to add, Paige, Jack, and Seneca did a nice job of filling you in about Chorus Fest, and you heard about Band Fest, so congratulations to those students. But I also wanted to add that I informed you last week that Mrs. Gray had taken a group to the STEM competition, but that same week, on March 10th, she and a group of teachers took two groups to the Reading Olympics, the Chester County Reading Olympics. One of the groups named themselves the Kidnappers of Knowledge, and that group consisted of John Beecher, Clayton Carlin, Maya Hahn, Owen Hoffman, Darby Kimberling, Kayla Kitlitz, Kieran Lomboy, Colin Nolan, Jillian Prusak, Keegan Quatman, Mackenzie Stanley, and Heidi Stalsfus. And the second group was the Reading Machines, and that group included Sam Bishop, Devin Carroll, Mark DiGregorio, Lily Gray, Patrick Hoffman, Jack Rocky, J.D. Mickle, and Emma Milligan. They read from a list of 45 books. They practiced by writing summaries, quizzing each other, and then both groups ended up doing very well and receiving blue ribbons. So I wanted to acknowledge them. They did a great job. And the teachers that went, Mrs. Gray, Mrs. Russell, Mrs. Finelli, they spent a lot of time working with the students each week, and so that was impressive on their part as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Student Council will be hosting a couple events for the end of the year. We will be hosting the Senior Citizen Prom on April 22nd from 5:30 to 7:30 in the high school gym. And we will also be selling food at OA Best on June 4th.
I want to add, I also found out recently that a student, I'm pleased to confirm that Chelsea Moore has been selected as a winner of the Chester County Women's Commission Empowered Young Woman Award for 2016. They select one student in the county. It's rather significant, and I'll have more information as that comes in the times and details, but she'll be going to a very nice presentation. It's very, well-regarded, and her efforts, to say the least, the story of this student is outstanding, and she's done a lot to deserve it. There'll be more information coming out as I get it, but I did want to note that she is the Chester County Women's Commission Empowered Young Woman Award winner for 2016, and there's one in the county, and I think that's awesome. So pass more on as I find out more.
Anxious to hear, and congratulations.
And just briefly, Mr. Reynolds did contact me at the end of last week to let me know that the music department has talked amongst themselves, and they actually have planned and been planning to have parent and student representation at the board meetings to talk about what's going on in the area of music. So this isn't just a, hey, at that time of year, we're going to talk. They're hoping to have a sustained, continual discussion with the board about what's going on in music. So I did feel it was fair to share that this evening, to balance our other conversation in executive session or in the finance meeting with this, I'm hoping we're going to see young people and some of the parents come out and tell us about the good things that are going on in that area, particularly the music department's really working at trying to make that happen. In response to Ms. Reynolds' question about how the teachers are trained or used in development, one of the pieces that my memo talked about was the administration sat down and the administration worked on the budget documents that they're being worked on, partially for the very reason that Ms. Reynolds indicated, probably unfair to hand that to the staff and say, here, good luck. We understand the numbers, we understand some of the pieces that happen more globally in the organization than an individual staff member would. We have asked out to the staff, based on their review of the document, for them to take a look, and if they have questions or if they have inputs with their administrators, to please talk with their principals to help inform the list of items and help us understand some of the impacts that maybe we didn't think about in that. So we've asked for that, but we didn't ask the teachers to actually create the list.
All right, board comments. And I will actually comment, because in talking about methodology and looking at reductions of the budget, we also, as a board, as we had in our finance committee, we had very in-depth discussions. You know, there's a lot of questions that get asked, and those questions always start with, what is the impact on the students? What is the impact on the students? And that is primary. Then it, you know, goes down to, what is the impact on the staff? What is the impact on the district? But there is a lot of discussion, a lot of questions, a lot of concern. There's a lot of information that is provided, and then the board directors have a lot of questions that are very well answered by the administration. And if they don't have the answer, they go back and get it. But there is a lot of discussion as well. So it's not, here's a list, check it off. So just so everyone knows, they're difficult decisions. They're very difficult decisions, but they're not made very lightly or without a lot of consideration. So board comments this evening.
I'd like to make a few comments this time. Last week, as many of you know, we had quite a lengthy discussion on the task force and what the task force is doing in our facilities committee meeting. And I would like to kind of direct some of these to some of the news articles that I've seen lately concerning that meeting. And I will read from Tim Alexander's blog, and it says on his blog, there is still a persistent push from the Field Development Task Force and some board members. And what he's talking about here is to move forward with this. And I don't recall that in any time in our discussion that the task force, they are raising the money. Tom and I don't attend them all, but Tom attends most of them. We attend those meetings, and it is our feeling that we are getting close to where we need. And we need, as a board, to be prepared that when they do get the money, that we can move forward. There's a timeline in which some of this work can be done. And he also mentioned something in his article about that we are voiding the agreement that we had published last fall.
That's not what I said.
The motion we had made last fall. We made a motion that when they reached a certain point, we could move forward. We wanted to get some of the things in the work, which is the school's responsibilities. And when you're on a facilities committee meeting and you work with these things, there's permits, there's blueprints, there's this and that has to be done. And you can't wait to the last minute to do these. And all we were doing was pushing, saying was, let's get some of these moving so that when they come up with the money, we can move forward. And that's where, and this didn't come from the task force. This come from, I'll take the blame for it, because I've talked to Tom, and I said, hey, we need to move forward. Tom agreed, and we brought it to the board. So it's
if they're going to have the money by June 2016, and they're not due to have it till June 2017, where's the sense of urgency that we need to start moving forward when they don't have the cash in hand?
You're misreading that, because it says we gave them a timeline that they have to have the money by June of 2017. If they have the money ahead, then we can do it. So the ideal time to do this would be during June, July, and August.
What was presented at last week's meeting was a change in the terms of the original vote.
Could you? Because I sat at the meeting, and at no time did anyone ask to change the terms. And my concern, my concern is that you wrote that the task force asked the district to move forward before meeting the terms. That was not true. The task force did not initiate the conversation, and it was never communicated that they did. So help me understand where you came up with that.
Dr. Newton brought it up.
Correct.
And he said, in meeting with the Field Development Task Force, they believed that they were going to have this money by a certain time. They had 45 when we had the vote.
Correct.
They believe they have 80 now. They suspect that they will have the remaining money, or a significant portion of the remaining money, through fundraisers by June.
Correct.
And the balance will be paid through various other private donations that they expect to get.
Mm-hmm.
And the request was to begin moving forward now so that the work can begin immediately with the expectation that the money will be there in June.
But let me clarify, the task force did not ask. Everything you said is correct, but you put as fact that the task force asked the district to move forward with renovations before meeting the terms. They did not bring this up they did not bring it up to the facility. They did not ask us. All they did was say, when asked, they had the money. It was a report.
The way Dr. Newcomb presented it.
To you, apparently, because.
Well, you just said everything I said was correct.
They did not ask. You have said that the task force was persistent. And the reason that I'm having this conversation, and we can have it in facilities, that when we as board directors, when we make comments, when we write things down, they need to be as factual as they can.
What I said was that the request was coming from them through Dr. Newcomb. His initial comments on this. Well, this is really why, on several occasions, I've said it's a good idea to put that camera in that room. So there is no he said, she said, because there is a lot of, there's no he said, she said out of this room, because everybody can see the recording. But on numerous occasions, there has been he said, she said, out of the committee meetings, and I think if we had video in there.
Public meetings,
nobody ever sees those meetings 99% of the time. I don't think we don't put committee meeting minutes up on the internet for people to review. We don't take video. I think it may be a good idea so that it's not my word against yours or his or anybody else's.
I'd just like to add a couple of things to that, because you said that Tom said. Tom was given a report of what they had, the task force, money they had, but he didn't specify that they were pushing for us to move forward. It was me and Tom that were pushing to move forward.
That was not my impression. Well, my impression was that they were asking to begin moving forward.
That was not true.
And then Brian started arguing that position, and then you agreed with him.
Well Tim, to clarify that a bit, and at no point in that meeting, at the facilities committee meeting last week, was it ever suggested that they not have to have the money up front before ground is broken. It was never suggested. And you clearly...
This is why we need video.
The impression that I got from
what Dr. Newcomb said and your argument of it was to go ahead and to begin
the process of collecting bids. There was no, you made it seem in your blog, Tim, and that I, and you mentioned me, I was the only person that was mentioned by name, by the way. you made it seem that I was willing to rip up the agreement, let's break ground tomorrow. It was the way it was read. And it was clearly read by one.
That's what I walked away from that meeting.
Well, that's your opinion. It was never stated factually by me.
It never was.
There was eight of us in that room.
It was just bids. Right?
It's just collective.
Initially it wasn't.
Yes, it
wasn't.
It was.
It came down to bids.
Tim, this is where. No, you.
Okay.
Wait. I think that the reason that we're having this discussion is not to bring back he said, she said, what happened. But the point is, if you are, as a board director, any of us, as much as that we say that when we're out in the public, we speak for ourselves, there is a certain standard. We're held to a higher standard. When you write things and they appear to be factual. You write in fact, you say the track renovation was not included in the five-year plan. I have a five-year plan right here that includes the track renovation. So my point is just, if you're going to, and you know what, I'm glad you write, because that I there's no problem with that. Just continually write, in my opinion, this is how it seemed to me. But when you say things like, the field force task asked this, when you say,
mistaken on that one point, we're moving forward without cash in hand.
We're getting a bid, and the point of getting a bid, well,
just
again,
to know what the price is,
but there's no cash involved. This is, the district's not spending money. But again, my point is, please just when you write things, if you have a question, if you're not sure of something, please ask for clarification or write that, in my opinion, this is what I heard. Persistent push, I haven't heard from a track person since September. Not one track person has come to any meeting. So I don't know how you come with the word persistent. So again,
like I said, I'm going to repeat myself again. The way it was presented, the initial comments from Dr. Newcomb, and I may have misheard, maybe I did, but it came across was to get this going so that ground could be broken, so that we can meet certain deadlines to have the track ready to go at a certain time.
Okay. Well,
and that was with the expectation that the money was going to be there. Not necessarily that the money was going to be in hand, and that this was coming from the Field Development Committee, who's asking, saying, we're expecting this to happen. Can we just get going?
Well, clearly there were different opinions, which is, again, that I just asked that if you're going to write things and you say this is what happened, that you just be clear and say, from my recollection, and don't state it as fact. And the problem is maybe that when people read it, again, you're held to a different standard. You are a board director. So when you say, this is stated as, we read it like this, they believe that it is the actual minutes that they're reading, not your impression of what
there's
we said.
There's nothing on there
so
that says that those are the actual minutes.
When I first
came on the board, I made changes to that site so that people knew exactly that it was coming from me and it was not an official document of the school board.
Can I read from one of the comments, and this is how things are interpreted. One of the residents, after reading your blog, when you clearly hinted that we were willing to rip up the original terms of the agreement, which was never stated, and clearly no one had that impression other than you, this is what one of the responses. What kind of moral lesson are we teaching our kids if we do not stick to our word or original agreements? And it'd be interesting to note in that meeting that did you actually propose not honoring that commitment.
What in that statement says that that's directed at you and not me?
What? No, I'm just saying, but it's the original intent, her response was based on us not honoring the terms of the agreement.
What makes you think?
I don't think she's talking about me. I'm saying in general. She's saying that we're not, as a board, we're not honoring our agreement. And that's not, nothing could be further from the case.
First of all, nothing's happened. But
I just think we need to be careful how we put things out there in such a public forum for digestion by our residents, that it be as close to factual, and if not, you write in your opinion.
You know what? Nothing stops. WordPress, that's a free blog service.
Yeah.
There are eight other members here. If you don't like what I write, you are more than welcome to put your opinion in writing, your version of these meetings, and okay, well, if you don't want to put your version of what happens in these meetings out there, then that's it.
Tim,
there's two versions. The minutes, three versions. That video, the minutes, and what I write on my blog. And if you're not willing to put out your version, then that's on you. That's not on me.
Okay, no, but what is on you is to be factual.
And I'm telling, and I don't know how many times I could state it, based on my impression of what Dr. Newcomb said and the reactions, the initial reactions, that's exactly what I was being in that block. Maybe I was wrong, maybe I misheard, but that happens. People are human, people make mistakes. Now, I'm wrong. If everybody here that was in that meeting says I was wrong, I'm wrong. But what I wrote was written based on my belief that was 100% factual.
Well, thank you. And again, that's the intent is that, we just are careful and we think about what we say. And if we have questions, if any of us have a question on what went down and we need clarification, this is the opportunity when we have other discussions to ask, because sometimes things might get misconstrued in a meeting. So, and again, we do have a 5-year plan, though. So, anything. Mr. Gano.
As I stated last week, the original agreement was that we had the original cost of $420,000,
right.
And we were going to put half of it in, which was $210,000. The indication that we got last week that there was a similar site done for $390,000 rather than the $420,000. So if that happens, and I use the scenario of $400,000, then our number comes down to $200,000. And it changes all the numbers, and that's what we have to do. What we're doing now is getting that number.
We said back when we passed it that they would have to have what percentage of the?
They would have to have, we said 134,000 of the 100.
I thought we actually did change it to percentage. 50%, right?
We're 50%.
Yeah, but 50%, and they're 50%. But then they had to have so much of their...
Correct, because of the top.
Yeah, of the topping on top. The cost of the topping, they had to have everything but the cost of the topping.
So, despite, he said, she said, we are putting it out for bid, we're going to come back to them, wait to see what those are before we...
And we won't move forward until we have the money.
Where are they? How much money do they have and how much do they think they're going to have?
They have 80,000 right now, and protected another 40.
I think they were short 9,000 that they needed in other donations in order to come up to the amount they.
Unless the cost of the project goes down.
Yeah, and with oil prices the way they are now, they couldn't come down.
All right, thank you.
All right, do we have any other comments?
Just briefly, congratulations again on Chorus Fest. Stay in chorus. I would like to thank Mr. Scott Cullen, Mr. Steve McBride for the preparation of the students for district and regional state band and chorus. we have Alexander Meek qualified for all state band, which is significant. There's only 22 or so band and chorus pictures up on the wall in the lobby. It's very significant. Chris Kelly will be playing a drum set with the All-State Vocal Jazz Ensemble. That will all be in Hershey the first week of April. Last weekend, my wife and I enjoyed hearing the regional chorus. Both my daughter, Meredith Fox, and Melina Yelovich were at regional chorus. I have this, I'll get the CD and I'll play the Star Spangled Banner maybe to open one of our board meetings here one of these times. You'll like it. on a different topic, March 9th, the Pennsylvania School Board Association sponsored a Pew Research webinar on the Pennsylvania pension funding issue and a solution that's currently being considered in Harrisburg. If anybody would like a copy of that presentation, I do have it. You can email me at bfox@octorera.org, and I'd be happy to distribute it to you. There's a suggestion that we encourage our local legislators to support that solution that helps us get out of the pension funding issue that the state currently faces. And that's it. Thanks.
I will piggyback on your course comment about staying in course, particularly if the board would stop arguing with one another. Lanchester Chorus is practicing tonight. I'd like to go sing. So it's something you can keep up with a lifetime.
Should have said that in the beginning, and then, you know.
And you might want to think about track, because apparently we're going to have this banging track that's going to be awesome to run on. So think about that as an activity.
Any other board comments this evening? All right, I will quickly announce the following meetings. The Finance Committee met this evening, Monday, March 21st at 5:30 in the District Conference Room. There will be an executive session for personnel and discussion of a legal matter this evening, Monday, March 21st, following the meeting, this meeting in the District Conference Room. Policy Committee meeting Monday, April 11th at 5:30, followed by the Facility Committee meeting Monday, April 11th at approximately 6 o'clock in the District Conference Room. The next regularly scheduled work session, Monday, April 11th, at 7 p.m. in the multipurpose room. Finance Committee meeting, Monday, April 18th at 5:30. And the next regularly scheduled board meeting is Monday, April 18th, 2016 at 7 p.m. And the Education Committee will be meeting Monday, April 25th at 6 p.m. May I have a motion for adjournment? Properly moved by Mr. Stolzfus and seconded by Mr. Norris. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting's adjourned. Thank you.